the peasant workers and intellectual students led by Frelimo, first under Eduardo Mulani and then under Samora Machel.
Dr. Famule.
Madam, can I just finish?
He's a teacher now.
Commissioner.
Yes, go ahead, go ahead.
I've taken my time to come before you, Commissioner. I'm a busy man at the moment. I'm presiding over the security of the state.
He has to go to see about the security of the state.
No.
Doctor.
Excuse me. Let me say something. You know, I'll come, Commissioner. I had a teacher. He was a very fantastic man. When he was lecturing, he felt that people were getting tired and bored. He would throw in a little joke. People laugh and come back to themselves. Madam Commissioner, yes.
Yes, and I know one of the traits of a teacher, if you try to your students and you see they're not getting it, you continue to let them say it over until you show they've gotten it. Also, that's a trait of a teacher. But since you're doing security business, I'm sure there's a lot in my file too, and you'll be objective to know that you've been there and you see what in your file, so you can be objective with mine. The next thing you said that Adlai Stevenson said, with no gains, if there's no pains, there will be no gains. Now, no, you didn't say. I'm quoting him now to show too that read too. So, but anyway, you said that we all have said that, and I don't want to just dwell on 1980 Samuel too, because we started with 1955 with the Jerry Coleman's episode, and also you brought out that your grandfather, the late Councilor Nadese Brownell, ran as vice president to the late Edwin Barclay, right? Yes. Okay, it seems as though he must have lost that election. And I see from your talk, and then what happened to your father? We too were small too, but we remember. And I remember when Doe took over, your father, the late Councilor H. Bowman Family Senior, delivered an oration. I think it was the 26th oration. Well, did he ever never deliver an oration or something?
The first anniversary of Redemption Day.
Huh?
The first anniversary of Redemption Day. The first anniversary of Redemption Day.
Oh yes, the first anniversary on Redemption Day. Could you, if you remember, could you tell us? Because I know there was some silent points in that redemption thing, because also we're doing history. And he has his own place. So for those who are not here and who didn't remember, he too has his place in history. And also Prince Brown, the late Prince Brown, he was also accused for a coup plot. And they had some... they had trials in which he denied it, but with your recollection, did he ever during the Doe regime admit that indeed there was an attempt to overthrow, to liberate his people? Do you remember?
Oh, my father?
Prince Brown, or your father?
No, I don't know much about Prince Brown, but let me say this about my father.
Yes.
I remember vividly what he said on the first anniversary of Redemption Day. He said that it was a golden opportunity for the first time in the history of the country when the masses of the people will now be able to choose their leaders freely and fairly. But then I remember he warned the PRC, he warned them that they were very young men and they must realize one thing, that Samuel Doe was the trunk of the tree. The members of the PRC were the branches. And Abdurrahman Boy Mofambole warned them The enemies will begin to chip at the branches. If you don't allow them, they will devour you, they will chip at the branches. When they have cut down all the branches, you will be standing alone, and then they will cut the tree down. The old man warned, though I remember very well, that was what stuck in my mind. Because sometimes he spoke in parable. And then the question of my father's trial. He read widely. He wrote. I remember an American journalist called Victor Dubois has a piece, The Trial of H. Boy Mofambole. And he sat in the court for 2 weeks and listened to the old man. And he wrote, he said, I sat there and listened to a Winston Churchill, Charles de Gaulle, a Kwame Nkrumah, a Nelson Mandela, a Lenny and a Mao Zedong all rolled into one. Because the old man really expressed himself about him wanting to overthrow the two-party government. No. I discussed with my father when he came from prison, released by Talbot, sick and broken, after spending 23 hours every day in close confinement. I wanted to know, I was grown up, about his trial. And he said to me, do you realize that I have always been critical of what was happening? I didn't hide it. I remember in his studies, he would take the seal of Liberia, and all great revolutionaries have this fantastic sense of humor. And he will write, where they have the Lord of Liberty brought us here, the old man will put under, the wand of money will carry you back. And I will laugh. He said these buggers love money so much. That's the problem. We laugh about it. And I said, but what this whole idea of you, government accusing you? He said, no. What these people really did, they met. Among themselves, they had said that Tubman was growing old. He was sick. The possibility existed that there would be a change, and that the people were mobilizing for that change. He said, so elements of this old oligarchy, they look across the landscape. They say, after Tubman, the people could demand that one of their sons become president after so many years, and they watch the landscape. And they single him out. Why did they single him out? I found later on, the journalist who wrote Mrs. Talbot's book, he died not so long ago, Gordon something, a British man. I ran into this man in London at the African Center, and he was talking about his long involvement with Liberia, how he knew Tubman or so. And then he made a slip. He said, you know, he didn't know who I was. He said, there was a diplomat here in London, a young man. And that man was very critical of the oligarchy. In fact, I informed Tubman that that man should be watched because he was dangerous. He said later on, of course, he was arrested from Nairobi. He was arrested in Nairobi, charged for treason. You know, sometime in politics, one must have unlimited endurance. I sat there, I watched this man telling me that he had alerted the regime that my father, who was reading philosophy, very critical as all young men in London, he had told the government. My father said, you know, when they look across the landscape, the person they saw was Fambula. And let me tell you something, which was a historical coincidence. I'd come from Freetown in 1966, going to join my father in Nairobi. I ran into a young man who was a cadet at the Foreign Ministry, Old Executive Mansion. This young man was a student at CWA. I'd gone for my passport. He said to me, you're Fambula Junior. I said, yes. And how is your father? I said, he's all right. What is it? He said, I read the reports of all the ambassadors. I'm very impressed with your father. His analytical reasoning. He's a very interesting man. I said, yes, then who are you? He said, I'm a cadet, I'm called Barkus Matthews. I said, thank you. This was 1966. Barkus Matthews. He was a young cadet at the foreign ministry down there. And so my father felt that these people had zero in on him. And in order to keep the people fighting, they were going to set an example of him. They were going to set an example of him. But what they failed to calculate at that time was they will give him a platform, not only to educate the world as to what was happening in Liberia, but to show the iniquity of a system where you would take an ambassador of your country, charge him with sedition, and within 72 hours you change that to treason, and you throw him in prison like a common criminal, and you sentence him to 20 years imprisonment, confiscation of property, hard labor. The significance of his trial was that he had already seen himself as a sacrificial lamb, and he was going to use the court to put them on trial, to indict them. Read his trial. Wish he did. And then, as you know, Tubman died in 71. Talbot, who was vice president, came up and said, if Ambassador Fambula is innocent, God will reveal that to me, I'll release him. But you were there with them, you should know whether he was innocent or not. A few weeks later, the old man was released. So the old man was never involved in any plot. He was critical, yes, as an educated man, as a man who had read economics, philosophy, logic, a man who was a lawyer, a trained lawyer. He was critical. But to say he was involved in an attempt to overthrow government, that was left to small Fambula to organize with people in Moja to see how we could push this oligarchy, which we did. And do I have regrets? Do I have regrets because the oligarchy fell? Then you don't know your history. It was my mission from the time I was 14. It became my dream from the time I slept in prison with my father. Cell 9, cell 11, it became my objective that these people had no reason to rule an African state in a continent searching for identity. And so,
thank you.
Those who feel pity for the oligarchy, write your history and sympathize with that oligarchy.
Thank you for giving us this piece of history. Thank you for giving us this piece of history, because the tree is never dead until the last seed is dead. So although Mr. Fambula is dead, but his seed can give us this history. What year was he released?
The old man was released in 1971. It was December 1971.
Thank you very much for participating in the TRC process, being a part of history as an actor, a visionary, a participant, and writing history. We hope that whenever we call upon you privately, you'll be able to fill in the blanks and help us. Thank you.
Good afternoon, Mr. Witness.
Okay. Good afternoon, Commissioner.
In your testimony, you answered probably all of the questions I would have asked. So I have just two short questions for you. As you speak of your experience and the experience of your family, basically your father, being arrested for treason and being demoralized under the guise of being a communist, I'm just trying to understand what was happening politically as a country that people were being arrested and charged with being communist. What was going on with the communist thing?
I think two reasons. And you see, we had a repetition of this in history. Each time a government in this country feels that it is losing touch with the masses of the people, it throws out this socialist communist card. This was during the Cold War. Dole tried to do the same thing. Tubman did it. This was a way of winning support from the Americans, more support. This man had been in office for almost 2 decades. Even the Americans, reading through the works of Professor Gus Leibniz, had started sensing that there was a need for change. And those around Mr. Tubman knew that he could not go on living for long. But how do you get the Americans to support you? This was the height of the Cold War. The Americans were afraid of any nationalistic government. And so this whole thing was thrown out about communists trying to overthrow the system. And Ambassador Fambule was this communist agent. Even when he was reading books to educate himself, books that other people were using to educate themselves, he wanted to educate himself. They said he was reading books of Lenin, of Mao. My father said, "I am an ambassador of Liberia. You sent me to represent you. I have to interact with the Russian ambassador, with the Chinese ambassador, with ambassador from other countries, the British ambassador, people who are well educated. What do I tell them if they ask me questions? I don't understand the word. I will have to read and educate myself." So it's a simple tactics of these governments. Tubman, the communists were here. And so the whole thing about Fambule's try to give themselves a breathing space was that in peaceful Liberia, where the Americans had so much invested, so much interest in terms of the communication system, this and that, there was a communist, a high-profile communist, an ambassador, who wanted to change the system. This man could not be. The man was a Muslim. He said his prayers. Communism, the business of communism is atheism. It's materialism, dialectical materialism. He could not believe in that. I know my father prayed. He went to the mosque. How could he be a communist? But they said this. People bought that. Mr. Toba did the same thing. When people were saying, don't increase the price of rice, there was a demonstration. People were arrested. They took pamphlets of little students, little boys who had gone to Cuba for the youth festival. One of them, very brilliant young man, had brought back to Liberia the sands from Playa de Ron, the Bay of Pigs. And he was showing his colleagues, yeah, sand from Bay of Pigs, the famous resistance of the Cuban people against the brigade coming to overthrow the regime. He brought this. They collected all these things. And the next thing we knew, there was this little pamphlet, the hammer and the sickle, communist foreign threat to destabilize Liberia. The communists were coming. The same ploy. That was during the Cold War, when you could fight in the Americans with all these lies, these tales. Today, Liberians are here. Chinese building them university, fix their stadium, building schools. The Chinese are good, the Liberian people say they are building these things. In those days, Omar Fambule perished in prison because he dared say that we must open up and embrace everybody. So I don't mind being called what they want to call me. Since you have not called Fambule a thief, he has not stolen money. As a young man, he served Minister of Education, Minister of Foreign Affairs. Fambule cannot be accused of exploiting the people. I'm satisfied what you call me. That's up to you. I know myself who I am. I have not told you anything about what I believe in, because that would take an entire analysis. But the problem here is that this country must realize that it must engage with all nations of the world against the fundamental background that the leadership understands its interests. You cannot be afraid of people. If the Chinese come, deal with the Chinese. If they can help your people plant rice, deal with that. If they can build hospitals, if the Cubans can come, if the Americans can come. Aren't you sure of yourself? You are not niggers. You are black men and women. So why are you afraid? So the whole communist boogie was meant to frighten right-wing circles in the United States. Right-wing circles, I'd say. Not Democrats. Right-wing circles in certain European countries. Fascists, like those led by Franco in Spain. Those led by Mussolini in Italy. Those led by Hitler in Germany. Who formed the metamorphosis in apartheid. Backward fascists. These are the people who always use the communist boogie. And when you had these long tailcoat bowler hat caricatures promoting that, people believed that. At the university, we were all communists because we taught something different. How can you send somebody to school in the United States? He comes back with a degree and he's teaching students. Students with very critical minds. I agree. Some of them have fires in the stomach, ideas in the head, but they can analyze for themselves. To even condemn us that we're communists, indoctrinating students, is to disrespect the very students because they know what is good for them. And funnily, most of the students who went to my classes are today some of the biggest right-wing elements you can think about. Not that they didn't learn, but student politics is student politics. They get there with ideas, they toy with ideas. They graduate, they get married, they come out of universities. They are men, they have to take care of the children. That's when you know who the real revolutionaries are. Not when you are young men in the university. We all went through that. We all wore our khaki trousers, t-shirts, Che Guevara, berets, sandals, impressing people. When you graduate and have children to feed, a wife who depends on you, a household, and you remain a revolutionary, ready to pay the price, then you are a revolutionary.
Dr. Famula, amongst several things, the TRSC mandate has asked us to also recommend reforms of the various institutions, including judiciary. So my next question is aimed at actually trying to help us understand what has happened with certain systems and how probably when we get to the point of making reforms, we can be better informed as to how we can go about it. You were exposed early on to how brutal any political system can be. You were in prison at a very young age, between 18 to 19 years old, and then in later years as an adult. I would just like for you to share with us some of your experiences in prison. What were the conditions in prison? And whether in later years when you were in prison, whether anything changed?
Well, put it this way. If you like, I had indoctrinated myself to believe that in a struggle in which I was involved, anything was possible. I realized that death was a certainty. It was a certainty. That's why when men wanted to fight and I believed in what they were doing, I decided to. I wanted to join them. Prison, the prison system was no different from prison anywhere. It is, if it's horrible, I guess it depends on what you expected in prison. You go into the villages, the peasants live on the bare floor, they sleep on the bare floor. They're exposed to the elements of nature. Prison is not meant to be a five-star hotel. So obviously, yes, we're giving dirty water to drink, but I expected that. We slept on the floor, but what's wrong with that? If you check your country, about 60% of the people sleep on the floor anyway. En masse. No. Prison conditions didn't change me. In front of my mind, the authorities were nice. They allowed, when I was a young boy of 18, when I was a man of 29 arrested, my